Once a month, she leaves her window and walks to the gloomy prison and enters at the gate. She can see him then with bars between them. She can have an hour's talk. And in these talks, he has described to her minutely every detail of his prison life. Hey there, welcome to Headlines and Voices, where we look at amazing newspaper articles from often a century or more ago. And absolutely, some of these things are so fascinating, frequently because they're so much like today. And when we do this research, that's one of the things that stands out to me the most is it just seems often just the same issues, the same problems, just different generations of people. Anyway, just want to remind you before we read this article that this is sponsored by Audio Mover. Audio Mover is the company that takes your old audio and videotapes, your history, and converts it into digital so you have a permanent archive. So if you have audio or videotapes or you know somebody that does, you probably do, go to audiomover.com. Get your order started and make sure that you get those tapes preserved in a way that you won't lose them and get that digital archive made. Anyway, that's audiomover.com. And of course, just want to ask you, if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, follow our channel, and leave any comments. When you look at some of these articles, I can't imagine that you wouldn't have something to say. These are so fascinating. So today's article is from the San Francisco Call, January 5th, 1913, and it's called In Sing Sing's A Woman's Vigil in Sing Sing's Shadow. Near the summit of a sloping street at Ossining, New York, is a house whose bow window looks almost directly downward on the little, evil, black-barred apertures that make the windows of Sing Sing Prison, an ugly clutter of tall chimneyed buildings halfway up the hill. Sing Sing is the prison known nationwide as the institution where New York State's most desperate criminals are incarcerated. In that bow window, a slender middle-aged woman has kept a tireless vigil for years, her eyes forever directed toward the prison below, save for such few hours as she may have a walk on the country roads, she is always watching the prison. When the long-drawn morning whistle shrieks above the prison walls, her watch begins and her mind's eye faithfully pictures a big, pallid-faced man walking through the steel corridors on his way with a long line of companions to the workshop benches. A man in whose blue eyes is a queer, half-insane light of hope. If it were not for the woman at the window at the top of the hill, the hope would probably have long ago gone out of his eyes. But he knows that she is always faithfully there thinking of him, ready to further any new plan that he may be able to devise in a long-continued, always baffled quest for precious freedom. Once a month, she leaves her window and walks to the gloomy prison and enters at the gate. She can see him then with bars between them. She can have an hour's talk. And in these talks, he has described to her minutely every detail of his prison life. And they have agreed on certain hours when they would engage in common thoughts. Sometimes, from her window, she will see a man walk out of the prison gate. If as soon as he stands in the free air, he stops short, lifts his head suddenly, and takes a long look at the sky and a slow long look at every house and tree, and then a quick backward look at the prison, after which he goes half running down the hill away from the place, she watches him jealously till he is out of sight. For she knows that this is a man who has just been set free. Invariably, they stop in this fashion. Act in this manner, just after the big steel door has swayed outward to give them release from the iron captivity in which they have been held. She watches the carriages that come daily winding up the hill and wonders what nature of man may be sitting shackled to a deputy sheriff within, what his crime has been, what punishment he faces. Sometimes she can see in far corners of the prison grounds men digging holes in the ground. That means that some wretch has secured freedom by way of the grave. But her vigil now is not as hideous as it once was. For this woman is the wife of Albert T. Patrick, and for a time, he was condemned to death. Then she lived in a heart-rending horror of some morning's dawn when she would see from her window the sudden dimming of the corridor lights through the ugly barred windows of the prison down the hill. She had learned that this sudden dimming of the lights and then almost as suddenly their flaring up again held a terrible meaning, a meaning well known also to the men inside. When they see it, some moan and others scream. And in the death house, the men behind the black curtains of their cells can only try to scream and choke on the utterance. They wring cold sweat from the fingers of their twisting hands. The darkness of their curtain cells has grown suddenly blacker. And only a little while before, scarcely a minute, they have heard the cruelly distinct shuffle of the slippered feet of the man who was led away. When the lights grow dim at the dawn in Sing Sing, it means the electric power has been borrowed for just that little while to send a murderer's body straining against the straps of the electric chair, snapping the life out of him. It was a queer marriage that this woman made with the murderer, William M. Rice, the millionaire recluse. It was after he had been convicted of the crime that she had drawn up a contract of marriage, which they both signed, but which they might not seal with so much as a single kiss. But it was legal. It gave her the privilege of visiting him more often in the death house, and gives her now the privilege of seeing the life prisoner once a month. She has mothered his two children. Another woman has now been doomed to take up the horrifying vigil on the death house that she once kept. Scrolling past a picture, the little pretty wife of the convicted policeman Becker. Such good fortune as came to Mrs. Patrick may not come to her. So she may be condemned some morning to watch the frightful dimming of the lights that will spell for her the news that the man she still faithfully continues to love has suffered the shameful murderer's death. Mrs. Patrick has met little Mrs. Becker at the gates of Sing Sing, and she has taught her all the little tricks of plan and thought by which, with love to strengthen the effort, she can almost feel her husband's presence and know his thoughts and actions every hour of the day. Although thick stone walls, steel doors, and screens hold them relentlessly apart. If they were assembled at the prison gate, the women, young and old, who have kept such gruesome vigils through days, weeks, and sometimes months, the line would be long and even more pitiable to look upon than the ashen faces of the death house men. It is a strange ever-passing procession of women of grief. They find their way to Ossining, taking up abode for a little time in whatever stranger's house may be induced to harbor them, staring out the windows by day and night at the prison which looms huge over all things in their outlook, staring with eyes of horror at every sunset that paints the Hudson gloriously, awakening with a sickening heart at the break of every new day, each of these things symbolizing the slow but inevitable approach of the thing they dread. When the day of death for the one they love has fallen, the killing stroke delivered, the only signal that is given these watchers is that dimming of the lights. There's not been for many years that old sign, the dropping of a flag. Only once in two decades has that signal been given, and that was when a woman, Martha Place, went to the chair. Great effort was made on account of her sex to save her from the terrific degradation. A mob cluttered at the prison entrance. The guards turned eyes down to a little square prison yard in which there is a door through which the witnesses of the execution had passed. A big man came out and held aloft a white handkerchief. He lowered his arm slowly, the handkerchief fluttering slightly in his fingers. The guards faced the crowd and said coldly, "Mrs. Place is dead." The crowd groaned and started to shuffle away. Then it halted sharply. Ferret eyes from the barred windows above had seen the slow, fluttering fall of the handkerchief, and soundless lips had passed the message along, tear over tear. Now, tear, in this case, it's not T-E-A-R, it's T-I-E-R. A horrible animal-like wail had burst through the infinitely numbered black windows. The crowd without fairly ran away from the sound of it. 2 days before, Carlisle Harris, the medical student who poisoned his girl wife, was put to death. His young brother alighted from a train at Ossining and helped his mother, a little withered, silver-haired woman, down. She huddled against the youth, afraid of the crowd's scrutiny. She saw her condemned son that day across the 3-foot barrier between cell and screen. In her talk with him, she made him say in just what manner he would spend the last hours of his life, when he would eat, when he would take his last exercise in the small enclosure of the prison yard in which the condemned take their last breaths of outdoor air, what hours he would give to thinking of her, what hours he would give to prayer. Then she went to the boarding house. Her other son had found her and sought to follow in imagination every act and thought and word of this boy marked to die in such great disgrace. When she came on the last day, the keepers that were there then looked at her little bent figure and suddenly looked at each other and then broke the prison rules. They pushed back the screen, opened the door of his cell, brought a chair for his mother and a chair for him, and jeopardized their jobs completely by looking hard away in the last minute of the parting. But they could not help hearing him tensely swearing to her that he was innocent, which was perhaps the best thing he ever did in his wretched life. It was jockeying with his soul, but it was unquestionably brave. Nobody remembers now the crime of Ferraro that put him in the death house. It was very brutal and stupid, a murder in the dregs. The man had the frame of an ox and the mind of a bad child, but the vigil that his homely, lowly mother kept outside the prison walls isn't forgotten, nor how she came to the village of Ossining and sold newspapers, chewing gum, and shoelaces that she might pay for a bed and food there in the last week of his life. Twice she was permitted to see him. A screen fixed 3 feet away from his cell door barred her from more than touching the lips of his shaking fingers each time they met. She said nothing to him directly. She simply looked at him with straining eyes while she kissed the cross of her rosary. But on the last night of his life, she didn't sleep. From the fall of darkness, she haunted the road directly outside the prison walls. Somehow, she had heard the significance of the dimming of the lights at dawn. When she saw it, she fell on her knees in the dust of the road. The vigils of all the women who have come near the death house have not, however, ended in a stare into black despair. Some escaped the frightening ordeal of the dimming lights. There was Eddie Wise's mother, who was herself admitted to stammer to him wildly that his sentence had been commuted by the governor. And there was fine old Mrs. Molyneux, who for more than 2 years lived in sight of the prison where her son Roland was caged, jealously guarding every little extra privilege that could be begged of the warden in the matter of the frequency of her visits and the length of time they might endure. She even wheeled the warden into permitting ice cream that his own keepers should purchase to be given to her son, with a share for all the other men around him. To this day, Molyneux, since retired and acquitted, has not forgotten how delicious that ice cream tasted in the hot, fetid air of the death house. Even now, every little while, he sends to the warden a check with a request that the men confined where he was once, be allowed this wonderfully refreshing treat. And that's the end of the article. Wow, that was something. So anyway, if you feel like listening to these things, please give a thumbs up to this video and follow our channel. And also, if you found anything interesting in there, which I can't imagine you didn't, to put a note down below and make some comments about what you thought of that, if anything stood out to you. And of course, make other comments letting us know if you like this kind of article or if there's some other kind we can do research and find and read on this channel. Anyway, thanks for listening. Headlines and Voices is sponsored by Audio Mover, the company that takes your history, your old audio and video tapes, and converts them into digital. Visit audiomover.com to learn more. Headlines and Voices is a production of Thick and Mystic Media. Visit thickandmystic.com.